Which one of these is actually for either of us?
A and C.
A and C, okay. Does anyone have any other answers? So this is the one that most everyone can call. Okay.
Wasn't
that's correct, all the above. But why is that? Okay. The reason for that is because there's no question that books and book author, that's a Cartesian product. And there's no question that this is also a Cartesian product. But then what about this? Well, you have books and book author, but look at what you're joining here. You're joining that book, the books table, with the books table. Are you thinking that is a cheap shot?
Yes.
that is a cheap shot. No, and I completely agree with you. Okay. But this is just to go and emphasize the point that you know, like, you need to make sure that you go and connect the tables that are of interest, okay? Otherwise, you get a partition product. And also, I think we've talked about this, that is when you actually have like something that, like an all the above, that appears right in the middle, you have to be suspicious of that option. Because that's nothing that can come up. Who in the world would do something like this? Okay, so there is that. Let's go ahead and
come check the test.
So we are looking to go ahead and get these results. So given these two tables, what do you think? What does this look like, this result? Is it an inner join, outer join? Is it not like any kind of join? We do know it's a join, right? Because you're getting the name from here and you're getting the description from there. So you're connecting the two tables. So that's that. Yes?
So because you didn't expressly say use a join to do it, you could have. It's okay if you just like didn't use a join but made it happen, right?
So what? How did you make it happen?
Select name from candidate where candidate ID select name where I did that too. No, I can't remember. I can't remember, but I'm pretty sure like the statement I used, I didn't use join.
So
but I,
the question is, you know, that if you actually want to go ahead and display it in this format, name being in one table, description some other table, would you have any other way?
I'd use name, comma, description,
so,
where.
So you want to go to the name, comma,
description.
Okay.
Where, from a candidate.
From a candidate.
Comma, party.
Party.
And then I said where candidate ID equals party ID.
Okay, so that's what we have. And in this case, you notice that we have the 1 is going to match up with the 1, the 2 is going to match up with the 2, and the 1 is going to match up with the 1. And of course, then we get a bunch of Republicans and Democrats, okay? And that's all we have. Okay, so that would be the natural. Yes, it is. Okay, so that's what we have. Let's go ahead and just see what happens if we want to go ahead and do this other piece. So given that same table, at this point, it looks like we have the descriptions, then we have the names, we have some empty slots. So then, that looks like a what kind of tool? That looks like an outer tool, okay? So let's go ahead and just try two syntaxes. One is actually going to use the actual left or right outer tool, and then the other one is to use the pluses. So let's go ahead and just do this piece here first, name description. And then from candidates, C, and then party P. Okay. And so what do you want me to put there? Where and what?
C.ID clause.
C.ID. So we have that, first and foremost, this outer join is first and foremost an inner join, right? So we do that. Now at this point, we need to go ahead and deal with the plus. The question is, where does the plus go? It goes on what, the candidate side or the party side? The candidate side, because on the candidate side is where we cannot actually go ahead and find matches for an the independent folks, the green folks, and the libertarians. We can't find those. And yet we want to go in and see them. So this is where, if we don't find the match, we don't really care. And if we don't care, well, the plus goes for the one that we don't care, which of course is sitting on the candidate side. So there's the plus side. So there's that. Now, what if we wanted to go in and use that other syntax, okay? So let's go ahead and just copy this. And so how does that work? So right over here, what do we put? Is that a right or a left?
Right.
Right. Okay, so right. Okay, is that good? Like that?
Replace the where.
Okay, replace the where we're going. Okay, so we're good, right? Now, of course, we could go ahead and do this here with that as well. We could actually go ahead and make it a left out, right? By putting party here and putting candidate here. Yes, we could do that as well. Okay, so with that in mind, let's go ahead and move on to this over here. How do you get this statement? So let's go ahead and copy this. And then you want me to go ahead and just take that plus and put it somewhere else. So it's the party side that we don't care, right? And then we're going to go ahead and do the same thing here as well. But this time, instead of right, we'll make it left. Yes? To place the emphasis on the candidate. Or, of course, we could go ahead and just change the placement of these two tables, and we could put this right, once again, to go ahead and place the emphasis on the candidate. Yeah? Okay, so this was all very easy, yes? Okay. Let's go ahead and find out what is going on. So we're going to be in this one. We want to go ahead and, how do you display the IDs that, the ID that is at the party table without the candidate? Using the exist clause. Okay, so how can we go ahead and do this? So, just in case you forgot, the ID that is in there, let's just go back to the original table. And let's go ahead and put it over here so that we know exactly what we're talking about. So it says, how do you display the ID that is in the party table? So in this case, it would be 3, 4, and 5. But that of the candidate table using exists in N minus. So go ahead.
Select ID from a party table. Then we do a minus. Select ID, and then we would do a natural join.
Select ID. And then, do we do a natural join? Do we need to do a natural join, or can we just go ahead and just do a select ID from the candidate table? Can we just do this? Then, yeah, so this is all the IDs in here, minus all the IDs in here. And so this will actually go and give us the stuff that is in here, but not in here. Okay, so now that's minus. What happens if we want to go ahead and use the not in clause? So what do you think of that?
Select party ID. Select ID.
Okay, so select party, well, let's just say select
ID,
ID
from
party
where not.
Where not?
No, where. Part where ID,
P,
is it P dot ID or
just
ID, not in,
not in.
Select,
select
ID from candidate.
Okay, so that's what we have. And then if we want to go ahead and use not exists or exists, whichever one.
Select ID.
So,
select select ID from party where.
Party where. Not exist. And then what do I put in?
Star.
Star, okay. From.
Candidate.
So when you find a match, you actually get a row. And when you get a row, you're going to go ahead and negate that, which means you make it false, which means you negate that row. But then, if you actually go ahead and don't find a match, you don't find any rows, which means that the opposite of that would be true, which means you accept that. Yeah? So those would be the three scenarios that you have. Any questions on that? Yes.
You know, it's kind of funny looking back at what I did for this, because I thought you meant exists in and minus in a single SQL statement.
Oh, okay. And so how did you refer to that?
I think I got it right, but it quite honestly was very inefficient code, a lot of bullshit.
I like that. That's right. That's right. Yes. Okay. Yeah, okay, so this is really what's going on. You know what, actually, when you say about BS, it makes me think about, well, let's just forget that, okay? all right, so then we come over here. So how do you get a unique listing of all the IDs that are in both tables? So we want to go ahead and have no duplicates on the SQL statement. So once again, a unique listing of all the IDs that are in both tables.
Select ID from candidate.
Select ID from candidate.
And then you can select ID from party.
Yeah. Now, what about union all? Does that do it? Or? That does give us the duplicates, right? So we don't want duplicates. Okay, so that takes care of that. Now, what about this one? Which of the following is not valid? Is this one about ISBN books order items?
Yeah,
that looks like it's good. What about this one, ISBN from books publisher where that equals to that?
That's not valid.
That's not valid because
there are two pluses.
We got two pluses. That's right. Okay, so that's not going to work. And then we come over here. Which of the following statements regarding an outer join between two tables is true?
I thought it was B.
B. Okay, I like that. Okay, let's go and find out what B said. To include unmatched records in the results. So this is, once again, we're looking at outer join. So when you don't match up the records, then you're going to go ahead and take the record, okay, that didn't match up, and connect it, pair it up, with a null record in the deficient table. And the deficient table will be the table for which there is no match record. I know these are just really bad terms, right? So yeah, that's what we have. Yes?
Could it be worded as unmatched records paired with a null record, maybe?
You know, I think you're right. Because deficient, like, that makes it like as if like there's something wrong with that table.
I took it as like, when I read it, as just like, it's just a blank, it's just paired up with a blank spot.
Yeah, and so.
But I do have a question.
You know, this reminds me of, like, you know, sometimes, you know, when people sign these contracts, you know, these lawyers, you know, the stuff that they write. It makes me think of that stuff. Like, you read it and you go, like, what the hell is just happening? All right, so.
When you, for the part A, when you say, like.
A?
Yeah. It says outer join operator. Is that the plus? What is
the A piece?
Outer join operator.
Oh, the outer join operator.
Is that the plus?
Well, yeah, that's right.
Okay, so yeah, when I read that, I thought it was the plus, and I was like, well, they both can't have a plus, so then that doesn't work.
Well, at this point, it doesn't say, there's no thing about an outer join operator. There's no operator. Oh, you know this one right here.
Yeah, when I read.
Both tables can include the outer join operators, and so this would be problematic because then this means
yeah.
There's a plus on both sides.
So I was like, oh, well, two pluses, you can't do it, and then so it's got to be that one.
All right. Well, I guess with that, we can shut this down. So we're shutting that down. Good. All right, and so let's come over here. And if I remember correctly, we were talking about views. And so we came to realize that views are kind of like tables. And except for one thing, they are not tables. You're not actually able to go ahead and copy the stuff over to some other space. It's that same table. And what you're doing is you're coming up with an alias for another name, okay, for that table. It's kind of like someone is called Jack, and then at home they're deciding to call them like Jay, okay? It's that same individual, but they just have two different ways of looking at it. Now, so here is an example of this view that we've created, create view simple, simple as, and then here we have this entire SQL statement associated with that view. And so this way, instead of actually having to go and type in this entire statement, you could just go on and say select asterisk from simple. And you could do your filtering based on this simple view, which means that whatever this thing is giving you, well, you can actually go ahead and give less, for example. And this asterisk that we're looking at, that corresponds to all the columns that you've made available. So the asterisk here is not the same thing as the asterisk as it pertains to the patient table. And so as you look at this patient ID, all that, okay, this is from simple. And notice that you can go ahead and do a describe just like a normal one. And then you can go ahead and select from the table or the view called simple. Okay. Now, I also indicated that, you know, what is going on is everything that Oracle does, it's able to go and store it inside itself. And so there's a table called user views, user underscore views. And so if you look at that, you go to user underscore views, and you're specifically interested in view simple that you created, you can go ahead and take a look at the actual text that makes up that view. So when you do that, take a look at this. That is the actual text that makes up the view. Now, my question to you is this. Would it be faster to go ahead and run a view, or would it be faster to go ahead and run just the normal SQL state? Which one would be the faster one?
For us to write or the computer to process?
For the computer to process.
Are you writing out the SQL statement?
I think
okay, when you write out the SQL statement?
Instead of
the view? And why would you say that?
I think
because it has to retrieve the statement as well as run it, as opposed to just running it.
Okay, that's exactly right. So the view is a little inefficient, okay, that there's that layer of translation that needs to take place. But of course, there's that convenience that you're actually being focused. Okay, now, there's something kind of interesting. When you go ahead and create a view, so by the way, you can draw up a view like you can draw up a table, and then here I go and create this view, and then you're able to go ahead and insert into the view. Now, when you're inserting into the view, you're actually inserting into the underlying table, right? So this means that if you're inserting into the underlying table, you should not violate any of the constraints of that underlying table. So if it just so happens that in the view that you have created, let's say you have a column that is the primary key, and of course the primary key needs to have a value, well, you would not be able to go ahead and insert anything into the view. Because when you're inserting it, it's as if you're inserting it into the table, and there is no place where you go ahead and put in any piece of information for the primary key. So here, insert into simple value, so the 999 goes with the patient ID, Robin to gender, I mean, Robin to L name, F gender, salary, and so now you're putting it in. Now, what is interesting is that, take a look at this. The view that we're looking at, it's looking at all the salaries that are less than 40,000, yes? But when you're inserting, you can door to put in people who are making less than 40,000. And you're also able to go in and put in people who are more than 40,000. So you can go and put in things that go outside of the social criteria. Now, people don't like that. Okay? There's some people who say, you know what, this doesn't really make any sense. So if you're only allowed to go ahead and take a look at stuff that is less than 40,000, then everything that you should, then everything that you do should actually go ahead and comply with this filter clause. So for this reason, all these SQL platforms, they actually go ahead and give you the syntax to go ahead and restrict it so that you remain within the restrictions that you have defined in your workflows, and we'll see that in just a second. So notice that when you go ahead and insert, so in this case, I'm trying to insert something, and this is violating the unique constraint. So once again, indicating that the underlying table, nothing must be violated. So here, we're actually inserting into this one right here, and once again, the unique constraint is being violated. We're starting from here, and at some point, apparently, I did go ahead and inserted those. When I inserted it, through, I guess, some of the mechanism, I forget exactly what, but that stuff, of course, is sitting inside the table, but of course, in the simple view, I'm not seeing it. So that just indicates that when you're displaying it, it's using that filter criteria. I go ahead and I insert into views cannot violate constraints, which is what we indicate. Inserts cannot violate check constraints, so we have, I guess, some kind of check constraint here. And the check constraint says, you know what, it has to be male or female. And we have to have a primary key. So in this case, we're trying to put somebody who's an H, and we don't really know what kind of gender that is. So indicating that when you're putting into the view, everything in the underlying table will still be okay. Now, there is something else here. It just so happens that for the inserting that you're doing into the view, even if it's outside the filtering condition, so we said we're interested in only the salaries that are less than 40,000. It just so happens that if there are no other constraints that are being violated, you'd be able to go and put in someone who's making 50,000. So that's outside the filter criteria. However, when it comes to updating and deleting, you have to go in and work within the bounds of your view. That is, you only have access to data that has been filtered. You can only go in and update the data that you have access to. You cannot go in and update stuff that is sitting on the table, like, you know, if you have someone who's actually made a salary of 90,000, you don't have access to that. So that's something to keep in mind. So, once again, if you're looking at anybody who is less than 40,000, and let's say you actually go ahead and insert someone, what? Okay. So if you're inserting, let's say, 30,000, that's fine. If you're inserting 90,000, that's fine as well. But now, if you try to go ahead and delete that 90,000, Oracle will actually go ahead and give you that message. Because when you're looking at your simple view, you don't have access to people who are making 90,000. You only have access to people who are making less than 40,000. So the inserts will work, but the delete doesn't work. And also, the update, the same thing. You're unable to go ahead and update this 90,000 to 20,000. You can't do that. Yes?
Could you update, say if it was 20,000, could you update it to 90,000?
Yeah, so in that case, once again, that would be fine. Okay, because you're getting access to a record that's available to you. But this one, you're trying to get access to a record that's not even available to you. So that's a problem. And I know that's a little confusing, okay, with regards to how the insert is really different from the delete and the update. And it is for this reason that you're able to go ahead and create a view and put a little clause in here such that that clause will actually go ahead and prevent you from putting in a record in which that violation is taking place. So this means that everything just kind of matches up. You cannot insert anything that goes less than greater than 40,000. You cannot delete, you cannot update, you can't delete that. And we'll find out what that looks like in just a second. So once again, this is just indicating that when you're trying to delete, when you're trying to update, all of these are going to create problems. You need to go and be within the domain of all the records that are available to you. Now, let's just say that you want to go and make sure that a view is only available for real. You don't want anyone to be able to change it. No updating, no deleting, no insert, okay, nothing like that. And so, if you just want to say with read only, this means that people can only look. That's it. They can't do anything else. And so you'll find that when you go ahead and issue that insert statement, it'll give you a syntax error. Now, do you remember that thing that I indicated with regards to the inconsistency between the insert, the update, and the delete? In that you can only update and delete the records that you have access to, but apparently you're able to go and insert records that go outside that range. Well, if you want to go ahead and make sure that even when you're inserting, you should be within the range of this filtering criteria, you could say with check option. Then that would mean that if you try to go ahead and insert something that's maybe 90,000, it'll give you an error message. So then everything there is consistent. The inserts, the updates, and the deletes. Yeah? Now, take a look at this. I go ahead and I go to the table. There it is. And I go ahead and select all the columns of the table by using the instructions. So, imagine as if I have, this, column one, column two, column three. And I just created this view symbol. And it actually is going to go ahead and, let's just say this is table, okay? And let's just say I go ahead and just pick everything. Then let's just say that later on, so I can go ahead and do a select asterisk and then it'll give me information for, all these columns. Now let's just say at some future point, I go to this table and I say I'd like to go and alter something about this table. I'd like to go ahead and add a column 4. There it is. I do this. Then, at this point, I go ahead and do a select from symbol. Now, the question that actually comes up is that when I go ahead and select from my symbol, after I've actually added column 4 into this table, will I be able to go and see column 4, or will I not?
No.
No. That's exactly it. Now, that's a little odd, right? Because you're thinking that when I created simple, create view simple, as it is select asterisk from table. And so that means all the columns. So if you add another column, it's still all the columns. But that's not how that works. The minute you change the underlying table, guess what? This view, it is still looking at the old structure. It doesn't recognize the modifications to the structure of the table. And so when you do a select asterisk from simple, it'll just go ahead and give you information on column 1, column 2, and column 3. If you want to go ahead and pick up that column 4 as well, you need to go ahead and drop the view, and you need to go ahead and recreate it. Does that make sense?
Can you double up views? Like, if you have an existing view, can you do create new view as old view plus something else?
Oh.
Like a nested view, kind of?
So you want to go and create a view from a view.
Yes.
I don't think there's any problem with that, because You know, at this point in the game, what it's really on is, I know this is always just bad news here. You know, when you look at the user underscore constraints table, when you look at all these tables that are the underlying table that Oracle uses, it just so happens that they're all views. And so Oracle is actually inserted into something, and so you can certainly go ahead and create the views from those views, you know, as well. So there's nothing stopping you from doing that. Because when you're, you know, interacting with these views, it's as if you're interacting with an actual table. The syntax looks very much the same. It doesn't make any difference. But behind the scenes, there's something else. Okay. So that is what is going on here. So we need to go and draw the simple view, and we need to go and recreate it. And that's how we're able to go and make it orange. And so there is that. Now, the question that actually comes up is, let's imagine as if you create a more complicated kind of view. So take a look at this. Salary, count asterisk, and then from patient, move by salary. Okay, so let's just say that you create a view that looks like that. Okay, fine. Now, we said that you could actually go ahead and insert into a view, you could update a view, you could delete it. Well, at the end of the day, when you're inserting, when you're updating, when you're deleting, you're inserting an individual row. You're deleting individual rows. You're updating individual rows. Now, if you're looking at this select statement right here, what kind of an insert would you have to do to go ahead and identify a single row in the underlying table, given what you're seeing between the select and the from? Can you even get to an individual record? You can't. So then when you actually go ahead and create these complicated views in which you have all these join conditions, you have all these group conditions, you know, that you go and incorporate, at the end of the day, because it makes it impossible to go ahead and arrive at a single record, just like right over here, this is collapsing all the records into this one summary record, which means that you don't have access to those original records. At this point, the inserting, the updating, and the deleting doesn't make any sense. And so you can't do it. So that's you know, a limitation that we need to consider, okay, with regards to modifications to these things. All right, now, there's also this thing called the top-end analysis. Okay, what is a top-end analysis? Let's say that we have these people. One of them is John. He's making like $100. Jill is making $50. Jack is making $3. And then John is making $10. Okay, so let's just say we have it. And let's just go with one more. Jim is making $150. So what if we are wanting to go ahead and take a look at the top two highest paid individual in this company? How would we see that? The top two. Or let's say we want to see the bottom two. So the top two would be what? John and Jim. How do I see John and Jim as the top two individuals? You guys have any opinions on this?
Well, we don't know how much they make.
Well, we don't care. We're saying, see, it's like if I ask you to go and tell me, give me the person who's actually making the most amount of money, right? You could actually go and use the max function. And so that could actually go and give you who's actually making the most amount of money, right? Or you could use the min function. But how do you come up with like the top two or the top three? max minus one?
No, that's not.
So you're saying you have max, and then maybe Jordan would say somehow you need to incorporate somebody who's making less than the max, and yet at the same time you need to go and keep the person who's making the max and the person who's making less than the max. That's quite a chore. Right there. Yeah, okay.
Alright, you would have, for the first person, you would do the selecting the person who matches up to the maximum value. The other one, you would use a minus. Okay, it's kind of complicated, but you would take the max of a join between all the records in the table minus the record that has the max. So that would get the number one person out of there, so the number two becomes the number one.
Yeah, that's enough to give you a heart attack. All right, so that's very troubling, right? I mean, there's a lot of, yes?
I'm there. I don't remember where, but you need to select something top two or top.
How about if you use the one?
Okay, that's what you. Okay, so you're saying there's got to be a top in there somewhere.
There is.
Okay. Yes. All right, so let's go ahead and just not keep you in suspense. Let's go ahead and find out what is going on. And let's not go ahead and use top, okay, or bottom. Okay, let's go ahead and see if there's something else to get into than the ideas behind what is going on here. You know, do you remember that I indicated that there is this pseudo call that all these tables have, right? And so what is going on is if you were to go ahead and insert, okay, this stuff into Oracle, then there's that pseudo number, okay, that's going to be, there's called row number, right? It's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, that's what we have. Now, there's an issue here, okay? When you actually go ahead and insert into the table, you can't say, like, give me all the people who are, let's say, one row 9. Is less than, let's say, 3, because that gives you the 150. So the row numbers here don't do anything for you, do they? Okay? But the row numbers can actually go in and out in another way. What if you were to go ahead and take this table that you have, and then feed it into a view? And then the view that you have is going to go ahead and do an order by. And this order by that you do is going to go ahead and order by, in ascending order, okay, or in descending order. So it could be, let's say, we're looking at the top two individuals, right? So we want to go ahead and have it in descending order. So when we go ahead and do that, what will occur is we'll have Jim, 150, John, 100, so on and so forth. And then in the process of actually this view, being that things are being done on the fly, guess what? We're actually going to go and get a whole series of new row numbers because things are being reordered. And so we get John, and then let's just go and go with one more, which is Joe, which is 50. And so at this point, given that we've actually taken this table through a view, what occurs is that the row numbers associated with this become that. And if that's the case, then if we actually go ahead and use the filtering criteria where row number is less than 3 against the view, guess what? We pick up the top 2 people. Do you see what's going on? Now, in the same way, we can actually go and pick up the bottom 2 people as well. We could go ahead and do an order by and ascend it. And so that means that Jack would appear first, and then Jill would actually appear, or actually Jack, and then John would appear, and then Jill, and so on and so forth. And then once again, it gets its own series of numbers. And so that takes care of it. Yes?
Does this mean the maximum and minimum is useless now?
No. So you're saying is max and min useless? So you're thinking that let's go ahead and just create a view where we actually order by, let's say, in ascending order, and then just go and pick up the record in which the row number is less than 2. Would you which means you just pick up the smallest item. That's what you're suggesting. You could do that, but then of course that just creates a somewhat inefficient route because you know you're going to a field, but that certainly would be an option. Yes. Now another thing you can actually go into at this point is, you know, we have been creating views and we give it a name like simple and then as, and then there's a SQL statement, select whatever, right? It won't happen. Now, one thing that we could actually go into is the following. We could say select, let's say asterisk from, and then normally here we go and put it to, yes, but let's go ahead and do something else. And here, let's go ahead and put a select statement. And this select statement is exactly the select statement that you're actually going to put in and associate with your view. So this then becomes a kind of inline view that you're creating. It is within the line of this SQL statement. And what happens is you're able to go and accomplish the exact same thing, except that you don't go through the process of creating a view. Now, why would you want to go ahead and do this as opposed to this right here? Well, if you're going to go ahead and do something only one time, there's no reason to create it. It's only being used for this one SQL statement. But if you want to go ahead and reuse this over and over again, you then want to go ahead and create a view. So it's up to you. So just to make sure that we know what is going on here. So here I go ahead and show you what is happening with RowNow. And so RowNow by itself will not do. And this is where you create the view and then you take a look at the RowNow and when you go to order by two. And you realize that the RowNows have now been reordered. And so now you're able to go ahead and pick up all the information, which is like the top three people or the bottom three people. And then here, I go ahead and share with you how you're able to go and guide and create a view. And just in parentheses, go ahead and do something like this. And there it is. Now, you know, before we get to the check conditions, check this check exercises, I think probably this is the best book that we have in this book. Let's go ahead and read this one carefully. So this is a conversation that Winston Churchill was having with this person. So this woman says, "Sir, you're drunk." And then Churchill says, "Madam, you're up. In the morning, I shall be sober." Do you like that? So he can recover from his drunkenness, but she can never recover from her ugliness. That's just next time somebody criticizes you, see if you can come up with a clever comeback like that. Okay. All right, so with that in mind, let's go ahead and see what this one does. Okay, so go ahead. Create a book called Colorful that contains the list of all those who have a good personality. This view should contain the last name, the date of birth, and 2 years, and personality description. Okay, so let's go ahead and hear from someone who thinks that they want to go ahead and say something, and they haven't said enough in this class. So, who would that be? Anyone? Let's see here.
What?
Anyone in the first row? How you doing? Okay, go ahead. Okay, let's give it a shot. All right, so what do you have for number one?
Oh,
okay, so
yeah.
We're
going to
create a
new
color.
Create new color.
Okay. Okay, so what is that select statement going to look like?
Last name.
So it would be last name.
Is that you have to go to the
So date of birth, okay. And so we need to go ahead and
that use. Looks so how does that simple as hell, but awesome as fuck.
We have to go to the
date. So can we do 2 dates or is there something else? How do we, so do we add years? How do we add years? If we had like an add years, or do we have like an add months? You've seen add months, haven't you? Right? microphone. So we go into like add months, maybe. So add months. And then we want to go ahead and make someone, I guess, what, 2 years older. So how do we actually go to make somebody 2 years old?
24 months.
What's that?
Add 24 months.
Do you add 24 months? If you add 24 months, are they becoming younger or are they becoming older? So if I go and add, let's say, 1 day to your date of birth, this means that you were actually born 1 day later, right?
Yeah.
So do you become younger or older?
Younger.
You become younger.
That's what everyone wishes.
What's that?
That's what everyone wishes.
What everyone wishes, yeah, okay. Well, then there's some people who actually come up with, you know, all this crap, you know, like, well, you know, you sort of acquire all this experience, so I don't want to be, that's not BS. You only have to say this because, well, what are you going to do? You have to just go and just live with these ideas to fool yourself. But you're right, okay, so in this case, we're going to go ahead and actually make you older. So make you even regret. All right, so how do we actually want to do it?
Negative 24.
What's it?
Negative 24.
Negative 24, that's correct. Okay, negative 24. So there it is. So negative 24. So there's last name, and there's the date of birth, and then we need the personality description. So that would be, we'll come back to you again. Go ahead.
Tom, the personality description.
Okay, so what's the description? Okay, from, and then what do you want to put in there? So what is the table? So we have person and personality. Okay. So the person table has got the last name, the date of birth, and the persona table has got the description. So so how do you want this to be?
Person B. Personality.
So person P and personality. R. Okay, and then
we have you where's the
okay, where so let's just say we have these IP columns. Let's just match it up. Okay, so how that work? So we're just doing a join. Right. So let's join on the IPs. The IP, that's right. So pair IP. Okay. Would that work? Okay, so it says create a polyfill that lists all those who have a good person. Okay, all right, so that's great. So let's go ahead and put an and. And so what is that other condition? Where or description is equal to good. Yeah? Okay, so we have that. And so we've just done that, so we've created that view. Let's go ahead and do this. Okay, so how do we draw the view? This is really easy.
Draw colorful.
Draw view colorful. And then let's go ahead and just deal with the top to white spade people in colorful. So how do you do it? Select. What is it?
Last name.
Last name.
Family.
Person. Oh, okay. Select.
Last name.
Okay. Or just let's just make it everything. Is it okay if we just make it everything? Yeah. Then from this everything, we are able to pick the last name of the salary.
Last name.
Okay.
So which one for is the box?
Yeah, you're adding.
Oh.
So you
gotcha. Okay.
So do I need to quote put last
so just
name here?
Yeah.
Or next segment is equally.
So basically we're saying that you know we are gonna go ahead and select and so we're gonna have all these columns, right? But then
oh, you're saying add months.
All these columns that are available to us. I'm going to go ahead and only pick last name and salary.
Okay.
So these two don't have to match up, right? I mean, it's kind of like, you know, when you have a table and a table's got all these columns, you can pick and choose what columns you want to display, right? So this is kind of like that same idea. You're going to go out and sort of come up with this result set that's got all of this data, and then you're going to go and pick and choose from that data whatever columns you want. Or no? Go ahead.
You need something of an asterisk so you can have something to order by. How do I see it?
Well, do you need that, or can you still order by?
Yeah,
I think you can order by what?
Oh, yeah, just if you have what you can, so don't need to say, you can give the asterisk.
So asterisk from, and how does the rest of it?
From
person. Asterisk from, is it person?
Cucumber.
And then,
order.
Order by, salary.
Descent.
Descent. Okay. And, so what is going on is, at this point, we have a bunch of people, and the top paid people are going to be up at the top, and then just go ahead and go down until we get to the lowest paying position. Now, do we do anything else with this?
Where yes. Ronum is less than three?
Where Ronum is less than three. So that gives us the tops. Yeah, yes.
So rows start at one, they don't start at zero, right? In the way of.
That's correct. So this is great in the world of computers, so it's always zero, but for us here, it's going to be one. Yeah. Okay, anyone else? Done. All right, so at this point, we're thinking maybe we've done enough, because after all, it looks like we finished every chapter. So let's go ahead and do some kind of an assignment on this. So I agree with you. Let's go ahead and find out what that assignment is going to look like. So let's go here and go here. Go here. And I know it doesn't look like we have too many assignments, so we need to generate some more assignments. Yeah, so because we have several weeks left, right? We have two more weeks left.
Yeah.
Is it three or is it two?
Three.
It's 3 weeks left. 3 weeks of what? Is that 3 weeks including finals, or is it 3 weeks of just lecture?
Because we're currently in week 14, so that means it's this week, next week, and the week after that. I'm not sure finals count as 3 weeks.
Finals is the Monday after 3 weeks from today.
Oh, okay, all right. So let's just actually, now that I don't believe you guys. So the finals.
Well, like I
do the calendar.
That's all I think. I like those food. Like I cook all the time. I just got followed by a bunch.
May 10th, right? That would be the.
I made this.
So it starts on May 10th. So look at that. This means we have 1, 2, and we have 3.
That was really good.
So it looks like we're going to go ahead and do other things. This is great. So then we'll get into the world of PL SQL. Okay. So maybe we'll actually be successful in finishing up the entire program. So that'll be good. Okay. So with that in mind, let's go ahead and. So anyway, you have this view. So let me go ahead and go in here and. So by the way, I'm completely aware that I've been reading everything consistently, and you guys were exactly, no, I agree. So I have a lot of veteran spots that I need to be catching up on that. So I'll be doing that. That'll be helpful. All right, well, ladies and gentlemen, looks like we are done. So, if you have any questions, that's the one.